Thank you. Good morning. It's good to be back at USD. I graduated in 1985 and then again in 1988. The first one didn't take, so I came back. And it's always nice to be back. This always feels like home to me. So something called us here this morning. You got an email about this morning's presentation, and something about it intrigued you. Maybe it was just, you know, you've been laying around all summer. I don't think that's true, but needed something to do on a Monday morning. So there was something about it that called us here this morning. And a lot of my work with leaders is helping people recognize the fact that when we raise our hand and say, yes, I will lead, we are responding to a call. That someone or some entity has tapped us and said, we'd like you to lead. And that is a serious undertaking and a big responsibility, and I would say a bigger responsibility than we sometimes acknowledge. And so this morning I want to talk about, the title of this morning's presentation was To Move the Needle, Start With Yourself. And we're all asked as leaders to move the needle, whether it's a business or a nonprofit, a service organization, get something done, move the needle. And in my work with leaders, I've come to realize that if we don't take care of ourselves first, we don't have anything to give other people. And we may be in charge, but we're not leaders. And I've come, that's my stake in the ground with all the leaders that I encounter. And it's after a very short period of time, usually within a day of watching them, going to their place of business and watching how they interact with their teams, looking at getting a feel for the culture of the organization, I can tell whether they're the leader or they're the boss. And I like to work with leaders or bosses who would like to become leaders. So today we're going to talk about, and it's not going to be me just talking at you for 45 minutes, so, you know, there is the audience participation. How do we move our own needle in order to be the kind of leaders that we've been called to be? And I would say that our teams, our organizations, and our society desperately needs. So let's jump in. So Gallup's State of the U.S. Workforce Report 2013, ever you seen that? A couple of you have seen that. What an indictment on us. So 70% of the workforce in the United States, they say, are either not engaged or actively disengaged in the workplace. So think about that. That's 100 million people, roughly, in the U.S. workforce. So 30 million people are engaged and inspired and fired up, ready to go, showing up, getting stuff done. That leaves 70 million people. Of those 70 million people, 50 million of them are like, eh. They show up, punch the clock, do their thing, go home. 20 million people, are actively disengaged. They've quit, but they haven't left the building. They stick around. And they keep talking and, you know, influencing the people around them, spreading their joy wherever they go. And we all know people like this, right? Some people quit and leave. A lot of people quit and stay. That's the bigger challenge for us. Can you imagine the cost to the U.S. economy in terms of lost productivity because 70 million people are either phoning it in or actively working against what the company and the organization is trying to achieve? So think about it. Greater risk in the workplace because people aren't paying attention. Lower quality products and services. Longer cycle times for new product development, manufacturing. The cost to our economy, Gallup estimates, is between $450 and $550 billion annually because of that number, 70%. So some people would look at that number and say, wow, engagement is a big problem. What are we going to do about it? And as a psychologist, I look for, well, what's really going on? What's underneath that number? And that 70% engagement number isn't the problem. It's the symptom. The problem is we have a colossal failure of leadership. Colossal. So, someone's trying to reach us. Morse code. So the problem is that failure of leadership. We've come to associate leadership with power, with position. Maybe it's me. Take me away. Take my phone out of here. Help me. We've come to associate leadership with being in charge, with having power and position, right? And I actually disagree with that perspective, if you haven't figured that out already. But if that's where we are, that's where we are, so that's where we have to start from. And so I think that there are three reasons why we've come to this place of we have leadership that's not working, and therefore we have 70 million people just in the U.S. By the way, the global report that Gallup put out is even worse. It's like 80-some percent of the world's workforce are just disengaged, not into it. So we're getting a message from the people that we're trying to lead and get to come along, and they're saying no. I think there's three reasons for that. So let me say what I think they are. And by the way, you don't have to agree with anything that I say today. Just want to share that with you. I learned that from a professor here. Hurts your grade, but you don't have to agree with anything. So the first reason why we have these kinds of numbers and why leadership is failing is because we've become unconscious. I think we lack self-awareness. We don't know who we are anymore. We're going so fast and with so much stuff coming at us that we've just lost touch with what we stand for, what our purpose is, who we are. We're on autopilot most of the time. We go to work, we're doing our thing, and then we go home, we watch Honey Boo Boo, we catch the game, and all the while, kids flying by us, spouses, partners asking for stuff, and we're still answering emails, working on spreadsheets, and we're doing that as mindlessly, so we're not paying attention to anyone or anything, and especially we're not paying attention to ourselves. So we're mindlessly going through this. So a French priest and scientist from early in the 20th century, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, said, "We are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience." And if we, and that makes sense to us in a lot of ways, but we think that we turn that off when we go to work. So I think we've lost sense of that. I had a professor here when I was working on my doctorate who talked about the equality between consciousness and spirituality. Same thing. So I'm not becoming more spiritual. I'm already spiritual. I just don't realize it because I think I'm a human being. We got to reverse that. It's my first stake in the ground. Again, you don't have to believe. That's what I think. And I think that's a challenge for us. If we want to be leaders, we need to become more conscious. The second reason that we're having a failure of leadership and we have that 70% engagement number is that for all of our technological connectivity, we are amazingly disconnected from one another. So first, I already said, we're disconnected from ourselves, right? We're not self-aware. We're showing up on autopilot. We aren't in touch with what's our highest intent for ourselves, for our teams, and for our organizations. We're disconnected from other people. We're growing apart. You just turn on cable news and you see how we are growing apart. Left and right, farther and farther apart. Citizens and immigrants, farther and farther apart. One community pitted against another community. One interest group against another interest group. And in the workplace, we can see that too. It's a little more subtle. But we don't take the time to get to know people. So a couple of my clients are global, they're dispersed all over the place, and so I spend a lot of time working with them virtually. And they're in virtual meetings most of the day, every day. And they go from one virtual meeting to another virtual meeting to another virtual. They just sit and stare at their computer screen all day long in WebEx or GoToMeeting, one of those. I'm doing commercials. I should get something free from one of those companies, don't you think? So they sit there and going through these meetings. And it's amazing. Jump on the call, multitask all through the call, and it just starts. Multitask all the way through the call. I know leaders who say they respond yes to meetings just so they can get work done. Because they can sit in that meeting and do stuff. So they're not even there. And then, okay, that's it, boom, and everybody, boom, boom, and you hear the bing, 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 everybody's gone. So we're not really connected. It's amazing. And one of my clients is all about connectivity and collaboration. And this is the way that they do their meetings. And they're not even conscious of the fact that, wow, so did you just see what just happened? There was no connectivity and no collaboration. And that's what you're selling. It's amazing. It's mind-blowing. And we've become disconnected from our planet. We've become short-term thinkers. We're making nearsighted decisions. We're endangering the ecological balance. In the last 50 years, of the 10 million species on the planet, 300,000 of them are gone in just 50 years. So we are quickly, and I'm not saying human activity is the only reason for that, but it's a factor, and that number is accelerating. It's growing, and it's accelerating. So, and that's because we're just not connected. Right? You know, Christianity talks about the mystical body of Christ. Buddhism talks about oneness. On the science side, Fritjof Capra, the author of The Web of Life, talks about the web of interrelatedness, the web of interbeing. And if we go back to Teilhard de Chardin, who says that we're spiritual beings having a human experience, then that interconnectedness, we are interconnected. Whether you like it or not, we're interconnected. And the last piece is, and it builds on the fact that we're unconscious and we're disconnected, is that we've become unconcerned. We just, to a large degree, there are many who don't care. Right? Part of that 70% figure are actually people in leadership positions, and they don't care. So we've got a challenge. I'm sorry to bring us all down on a Monday morning, but I'm going to bring us back up because you're here. So this is great news. So we're asking people with a 300 batting average, which is great in baseball but not great in leadership, to move the needle and get things done and make things happen and cause some changes, right? Those of you who are MBA students, you get this more than any of us. What do we want to do? At the end of the day, it's all about let's increase revenue, let's decrease cost, and let's lower risk. There, I just gave you MBA shorthand. Did I get it right, MBA students? MBA grads? That's it. So that's who we're counting on for leadership, these people who are kind of like, eh, or playing boss but not being real leaders. So our challenge is to wake up and help people lead by design and begin to move the needle. And so if we want to move the needle in terms of the business, right, we need to move the needle in a couple of other places. So the first needle we need to move, I just said, is we need to, especially if we're in a for-profit organization, we need to move the business from A to B over and over and over again. It's what we do when we're leaders. Raise revenue, reduce the costs associated with raising revenue, and keep the risk as low as possible. So we need to move the needle in terms of business results. And I say that's probably the easiest needle for us to move, especially if you're a company of one person. You have no excuse. Move that needle. But if you're not in a company of one person, then you've got a problem because there are other people involved. And other people, it means it gets messy. Because it's humans. Business is not business to business, business to consumer. All business is human to human. And so the next needle that we have to move and become more intentional about how we design it is we need to move the needle on engagement. And how do we get people to shift from being a ragtag group of individuals who don't even like one another to becoming a high-performing team? How do we help people come together, work together, and stay together? That's a bigger ask. And that's a lot harder. And as we move up in leadership from individual contributor, frontline manager to, directors on up, the higher we go, the more it becomes about people. I worked with a number of CFOs a number of years. We're working in an organization with early career high potential employees. So it was, people in their late 20s, early 30s, just about to move into their first time people manager role. And they're fired up. They're a great group. And all of the CFOs in this global organization committed to mentoring one of these early career high potentials. So think about that. It's like I had 12 CFOs from all these different companies within this global organization, and they said, we want to help these young people who are just starting out. Fabulous. And I sat down with all of them, with the younger people in the room, and I said, how much of your time do you spend, you're all CFOs, how much of your time do you spend on spreadsheets, on finance? What do you think they said? 25%? It was lower. 5 to 10% of their time was spent on finance. Everything else was people. So if you want to accelerate your career, delegate all the non-people stuff and take all the people stuff that you can. That's the secret. And it's the harder work, right? It's not the easiest needle to move. It takes more thought, it takes more time, and it takes more of our reserves, more of our resources. So forming and sustaining those high-performing teams, keeping people engaged, requires us to focus our attention and focus our intention. What do we want to do? What do these people need in order to show up and give their best? Ari de Hoos, a wonderful man, Dutch, worked for Royal Dutch Shell for years and years and years, conceptualized what's known as scenario planning. He wrote a book a number of years ago called The Living Company. And in The Living Company, he said that the role of the leader is to give people what they need so that they will voluntarily give their best. But voluntarily, I don't even have to ask them. They'll voluntarily give their best. So that's what my job as a leader of a team is. Now, I can't delegate team leadership. I can't say to my chief of staff or to my ops lead, okay, you're in charge of keeping everybody engaged and fired up and ready to go. Because I'm going to drive us. You can't delegate it. How do we help individuals to be their best and give their best all the time, right? How do we help those people to move their needle? And the reality is that the way that we do that is by moving our own needle. I think, and that's what I say to the leaders that I work with, that leadership is a lifelong journey, and it's a daily practice. And it's mostly a practice in being more of who I am and being able to relate to people around me without wanting to kill them or them wanting to kill me. Right? Can't we all just get along? One of the clearest voices on leadership, I think, was a man named John W. Gardner. Gardner was in the Marines in World War II. He went on to be Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare under LBJ. He actually resigned from that position because he disagreed with the administration over the Vietnam War. But he wrote a wonderful book called On Leadership. And in On Leadership, he said, leadership is the process of persuasion or example by which an individual or a leadership team induces a group to pursue objectives held by the leader or shared by the leader and his or her followers. I like that definition. And I encourage you, it's hard to find it now. I think it's out at printing, but you can find it on eBay. And what strikes me in this is persuasion or example. So my professors at USD, one of them in particularly, Father Pachance, in my class on Who is Jesus? Anybody take Who is Jesus 100 years ago when he still offered that class? And he said that Jesus taught through not just deeds, but words. So words and deeds, persuasion and example. Buddha, same thing. All great teachers use not just words, but they use actions. So leaders can learn from some pretty cool leaders from a long time ago. So that's not just position and power. In fact, it's not position or power. That's relationship and influence. Right? Being in charge has a shelf life. Leadership has no shelf life. So my simplified version of Gardner's definition is that leadership is the capacity to get people to willingly, enthusiastically, and repeatedly say yes, to journey with me, to go the distance, and do some good work. I call it ultra leadership. So getting willingly, there's no coercion, no I'm the boss, no reliance on position or power. To come with me enthusiastically, yes, I'll go with you. No hesitation, fully engaged, and repeatedly, over and over and over again, they'll say yes, they want to come along. They want to be a part of the work. So to get people to willingly, enthusiastically, and repeatedly say yes and move the needle requires a different kind of a mindset for us. It requires that we move our own needle, right, and lead by design. It's from showing up on autopilot to leading with intention, to leading by design. So that's me. So the reason why I put that there is that's the journey. If we're going to lead others, that's the journey we're called to move our own needle. So 10 years ago, I was a couch potato. 5 years ago, I got serious about running. 3 years ago, I ran my first ultra marathon. It's any distance farther than a marathon or multi-day. And I run so slow, it usually does take multi-day. And I just had to, I decided it was time to do something different. And get up off the couch. It helped that my wife is an ultra marathoner. If I wanted to see my wife, I needed to go where she was, and that was out on these trails. And what I've learned in this that's helped me as a leader is that, and I knew this before, but life is a series of choices. So this morning you had a choice. Should I get up and go to USD this morning or not? How am I going to engage with my team today? How am I going to engage with my partner or spouse today? How am I going to be when the Starbucks barista gets my order wrong, darn, or something doesn't happen fast enough? Everything is a choice. We have a choice to say yes and move forward when it comes to our own leadership. We have a choice to stand still, or we have a choice to go back. Only one of those is a good choice, but we do have three choices. So a couple of years ago, I was running an event called the Trans Rockies in Colorado. It's 6 days, 125 miles. And I experienced that life is a series of choices, and we have three choices in every moment, existentially, on this day. So this is day two. Day two is up and over Hope Pass, 12,600 feet. And on the climb, I was struggling. Now, this is not, I'm new to this. So it takes me, it's hard. And on the climb, I'm struggling. And one of my running mentors was did the Trans Rockies with me. And he's 70, by the way. And he comes up behind me. And, you know, and I've got poles because I have no cartilage in my knee. I'm just going, doing my thing, you know, not trying not to die, you know, because it's. And he just comes up behind me. Hey, Greg, how you doing? And I said, he says, you know, you can't go back because the starting line's gone, right? It's point to point. So there's no turning back. Okay, I'll see you. And off he goes, passes me. Never saw him again, that race. He just blew by me. And so I'm by myself, and I'm on my way up to Hope Pass. I'm in the middle of the Rockies, and I can't turn around because there's no one there. There's no there to go back to. I can't just stop because I'm there. And it would probably become night eventually. And so the only option was to go forward. And so I became hyper-conscious in that moment. There's only one thing I can do, and that's go forward. And so all I had control over was my ability to breathe and my ability to take a step. That's all I focused on for the rest of the climb and most of the downhill again. And I repeated to myself, I started just talking to myself, and I kept saying, just go to the edge, push farther, and repeat. That became my mantra as I was breathing. Go to the edge, push farther, and repeat. And it became a mantra that I used that day, that I use in a lot of long races, and I use as a leader. Because as a leader, I get challenged all the time. I have an individual who is having a challenge, and I need to have a challenging, difficult conversation with them. I have a team that's not performing the way I'd like to. And so it's hard, right? Leadership is inconvenient most of the time and uncomfortable a lot of the time. It's also rewarding all of the time. And so as hard as leadership is, it's not Hope Pass hard. I have a friend who's a cancer survivor, and she puts it in perspective of, you know what? Yeah, leadership is hard, but it's not cancer hard. So it gives perspective for us as leaders. So that's the view from the top of Hope Pass, by the way. So if we aspire to lead others, then we're answering the call to move our own needle, to go on the hero's journey and figure out who we are as people and how we want to engage other people. It's a lifelong journey, and it's a daily practice of becoming more conscious, more connected, and more concerned. Right? More conscious means being more self-aware of who we are emotionally, cognitively, physically. No autopilot. How do we figure out a way to keep ourselves awake as we're going through life? It means being able to answer the question, who am I? What do I stand for? What's my important work? It means thinking more carefully, feeling more fully, and communicating more effectively. Think of all the leadership skills that we get taught in leadership development programs. Oh, we're going to do coaching, we're going to do negotiation, problem solving, decision making, all of it. It all boils down to, can I think more carefully? Can I feel more fully? And can I communicate effectively? If we get those three things, all the other stuff's going to happen. More connected. We become more aware of and in tune with other people and the world. In business, that means putting people before tasks. There's a lot of talk about the differentiation between what's a manager, what's a leader. right? We manage tasks, we lead people. People do not need, like to think that they are a task. And more concerned, more sympathetic, more empathetic with the people that we're encountering, that we care about people. People want to know that we care about them. In business, that's looking for the win-win. It's also a sign of our trustworthiness as a person and as a leader. People want to trust that we are concerned for them. And they're making a decision about our trustworthiness all the time. So we have to live up to that. So why would we bother doing all of this? Because we're leaving a legacy. That's why. So we can leave a legacy by default, or we can leave a legacy by design. Right? We're leaving a legacy right now, today, every day, at the end of a conversation, at the end of a meeting, at the end of working at one company and going to another company, and at the end of our lives. There's a story being written about us, and we can let somebody else write it, or we can write it ourselves. People at work right now are talking about you. While you're here, someone's talking about you. Don't you feel important? How confident are you about what they're saying? Is it good stuff? Or is it how you showed up in the last meeting and it wasn't your best day? So I think we're more in control of the story than we realize. Joseph Campbell, who wrote The Hero with a Thousand Faces, said, "A hero is someone who's given his life to something bigger than himself." So there's some paper in front of you. There's a piece of paper in front of you, and I'd like us to take a couple of minutes so that I can stop talking for a couple of minutes for us to consider what we are giving ourselves to and be more intentional about the contribution that we're making. Can we be more conscious, more connected, more concerned? So I'd like you to think for a minute, what are you hoping to contribute to your organization in the next 6 months? And if 6 months doesn't work for you, maybe it's just the next quarter or the next week. What are a couple of things that you want to contribute to your organization? What do you hope to contribute to your team in terms of the experience that you have collectively? If we're going to be intentional about that, what are a couple of things that you'd hope to contribute to that team experience? And lastly, what do you hope to contribute to your own development in the next 6 months, quarter, whatever, right? How are you, if you were going to grow yourself as a leader, what do you want to focus on? And I always, when I'm coaching people, three things is a lot of things to work on in 6 months. 6 months is not a long time. So I always keep it to three things. What are the three things that we want to move the needle on and have people notice, wow, you've grown in these three areas? So that's why it's no more than three for those things. So I'd like you to think about that for a couple of minutes. And then, so there's the conscious part. Here's the connected and concerned part. I'd like you, after you take a couple of minutes and look at those questions and jot down a couple of things, I'd like you to turn and have a quick conversation with the person next to you. Make a connection. If you haven't said hello and what's your name yet, that might be a good thing to start with. And have a chat about what's on that piece of paper. Okay, so I'm going to put on a little music for you to reflect and become conscious and connected and concerned right here in the room before you head off to work, okay? So let's take five minutes or so. I'll keep an eye on things, but I'd like you to do a little work now, okay? So the energy is amazing as we take the time, reflect, and connect with other people and share a little bit of ourselves with one another. And I encourage you, maybe the person that you just met could be an accountability partner for you, you know, as you move forward. Maybe you get together and have a coffee every, you know, month or so and just check in. Remember what we said when we are at that thing that Greg did. And how you doing with that? Who's Greg? Yeah, exactly. Remember that guy? So I want to wrap up, and then there's refreshments in the hallway, and you can hang out all day and continue the conversations that you just began. There's a prayer that's attributed to Francis of Assisi that I think provides us a means to check our capacity to be ultra leaders, our capacity to be conscious and connected and concerned, and that if we agree that we don't want to turn off our nature when just because we're at work, then how can we bring our true selves and our best selves to our work as leaders in order to get that 70% number down and make the world a better place? We need leaders, and it radiates out no matter what kind of leader we are. So regardless of your particular religious affiliation or spiritual practice, I think the prayer suggests a powerful how to live and lead consciously and with connection and with concern for other people, right? Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. So the question for us there is, do I value love over hate and resentment or winning or ending up with the most money or the toys or conquests than the next person, right? What do I value more? Where there is injury, pardon. Do I bring reconciliation and healing to my relationships or allow others to continue to suffer, including the people at work? Where there is discord, union. Do I attempt to make peace in my relationships or do I thrive on the discord and use it for my own gain? Where there is doubt, faith. Do I reassure those around me with the strength of my conviction? Are those people in relationship with me certain of my concern and my commitment for them? Where there is despair, hope. Do I convey a basic trust in myself and in the world that enables those people around me to draw some hope from my presence? Where there is darkness, light. Do I seek the happiness and well-being of other people? Or do I sow clouds of darkness with cutting words and gossip and negativity? Where there is sadness, joy. Do I encounter others with a sense of enjoyment and wonder and gratitude? Grant that I may seek not so much to be consoled as to console. Do I need and take more consolation than I offer? To be understood as to understand. Do I notice the world that I'm moving through every day? To love, to be loved as to love. Do I offer myself in real and honest relationships to as many people as I possibly can? How many people are in my circle of concern? And what can I do to keep making that circle bigger? And this is the true or false question. We either believe this or we don't. For it is in giving that we receive, it's in pardoning that we're pardoned, and it is in dying to ourselves that we receive eternal and inexhaustible life. Right? We give it away and we get more back in return. It's a mystery. So our organizations, our teams, the people we lead, our communities are calling out for leadership. We need conscious and connected and concerned leaders. And we need ultra leaders who are going to answer yes to the call to take the hero's journey. So dying to self for me means this, right? Going on the journey. This is a poem by Patrick Kavanaugh, The Self-Slaved. Me, I will throw away, me sufficient for the day, the sticky self that clings, adhesions on the wings to love and adventure, To go on the grand tour, one must be free of self-necessity. To go on the grand tour, one must be free of self-necessity. I need to be willing to let go every day and keep stepping forward. I hope you'll stay connected with me. I'm on LinkedIn. If you can spell my name, you can find me. We're on Facebook. I tweet a lot, just for myself, mostly. And I do blog, and the blog posts are on LinkedIn as well. So I want to thank you for inviting me to be with you today. It's always an honor to be in a room full of leaders. And leaders are what show up to something like this, not people in charge. So I thank you. Thank you. Let me just also thank the professors and teachers that I had here who were challenging and patient with me over the years. I want to thank USD and Masters of Science in Executive Leadership for letting me be here. Christina and Gina, thank you for your hospitality. I appreciate it. And it's been a wonderful, wonderful morning. So thank you for your engagement and for your energy this morning. I really appreciate it. Please connect, and I'll leave you with this, right? It's leadership is inconvenient and uncomfortable, but it's rewarding. And there's going to be times where, as a leader, where you feel like you're out on a trail in the middle of nowhere and you just want to sit down and cry and go home. And you can't. The run is point to point. There's nowhere to go except forward. And so just remember, you can't stop. You're the leader. You got to keep going. And so go to the edge. Push farther and repeat. Okay? Thank you.